conditioning, and then you can go back out to the sunshine and all that after this. Some of you are here for the first time to see this production, and we are so thankful for you. Some of you are just wonderful parents, grandparents, friends, and you're back for more, and we love that too. So thank you for supporting your actor today in this production of 15 Reasons Not to Be in a Play. This show has been so fun to work with these young actors. I want to thank you, parents and grandparents and friends, for all of the time that you have committed to getting them here and rehearsing and all of that. They've just been such a joy to work with. A couple things I want to let you know about the show. Yes, you can take photos, videos, all that good stuff. Make sure your phone is silenced. Don't do the flash or the sounds or any of that. But please, as your actors having their moment, and this show is really fun because every single one of the 15 of them have moments where they get to shine and do some things. So have your phones out and ready if that's something you're interested in. We are filming this show, not live stream, but just filming it, kind of having a recording of that. And that's something that we like to do at the Opera House. If you're interested in acquiring a private link to that later, we'll see what we can do. We may know some people whose last name rhymes with Holcomb that we can help out. So just be aware of that. A couple of upcoming dates and performances that we also want to keep you in the loop on. Next weekend, a fine, hilarious comedy opens. In fact, you'll see that some of the backdrop here we are thankful to get to share with, but that is Leading Ladies, and the director for that show, AJ, is right back here in the back. So if you want to know more about that show, it runs 3 weekends. Don't miss that. Additionally, at the end of May, we've got a musical that is a funny musical. It's probably one of the more classic musicals out there. It's dark, and the music is good. Little Shop of Horrors, you see that in your program, and so that runs 3 weekends. In between those two, at the end of April, right over here to my left, your right, there's a giant table with 12 chairs. The Teen Academy, right smack in the center of the theater, will be putting on 12 Angry Jurors, which is the play of 12 Angry Men. So they'll be in the round. We'll be selling general admission seats for the whole theater inside and some special VIP seats for the stage that you can sit on the stage and feel special, have a personal runner to the snack bar for you, all of that stuff, okay, if that's your thing. So, don't miss that 1 weekend only, end of April. I think that's about it. I'm good. We're good. We're excited to bring you this last show. Would you please help me welcome the cast of 15 Reasons Not to Be in a Play?
A play, it stinks being you.
We believe that putting on a play is a bad idea.
And a horrible idea.
A rotten idea.
A putrid, stinking, slimy, greenish liquid oozing.
You'd rather kiss your brother full on the mouth than have to deal with this idea.
We are going to do it. Period.
So don't ask. Don't.
And whatever you do, don't beg. It makes us sick.
But we are out here, and you may wonder why.
We're out here with a message.
We're out here with a warning.
We're out here.
15 reasons not to be in a play! Reason number one!
Plays stink!
Reason number two!
When you were in second grade, you had a teacher named Miss Grindwald. She was older than dirt, and she smelled like stale coffee and gym socks. When she came in every morning, she said,
"Now, students, pay close attention. Focus, focus, focus is the key to success."
She invented amazing methods of torture using construction paper and popsicle sticks. She turned perfectly normal questions into statistic gains of chance that you would always lose.
Miss Griswold, can I go to the bathroom?
I don't know. May you?
What?
May you go to the bathroom?
That's what I'm asking. Can I go?
I'm assuming that you can, but I don't yet know if you may.
Miss Griswold, I really have to go.
Then you can go.
Thank you.
But you may not go until I have given my permission.
Miss Griswold.
you'd either made a puddle on the floor or had ran out in desperation. A crowd of which you had to pay by writing, "I will not run out of the room in desperation," on the board 7 million times with your breathing on you until you got it done. Miss Griswold.
Miss Griswold.
You had Miss Griswold and she decided to put you in a play.
Only in second grade, still in your formative years.
The play was about love and the earth, and you spent weeks with your hands in papier-mâché trying to put together the costumes and props.
Only 7 years old and so terribly impressionable.
It was a play Miss Griswold wrote, and it had lines in it like, "If we don't get busy and plant all those seeds, the earth won't be able to meet our needs."
No, no, Emily. Put more emphasis on the word needs. I want you to really experience that word fully. I want you to taste it in your mouth. Say needs.
Needs.
Say it like you mean.
Needs.
Say it as if the most important thing for you to do right now is to say the word needs.
Needs!
Emily, say it as if I'm going to take you home and throw you in a hot oven if you don't say the word needs right.
Needs!
Much better.
You were small for your age. Everything was so intimidating to you. Especially Miss Griswold.
Miss Griswold!
She put you in a tree costume. It itched like you had lice all over your body. When you tried to turn your head, you faced the side of the tree and you couldn't see.
Miss Griswold, I can't see!
Now, Emily, how are you going to say needs?
With feeling, with passion, I don't want to go in your oven!
Stop crying, we're about to go on. Now, where's my head of broccoli?
Miss Griswold, I can't.
Quiet, we're about to start.
You felt tiny and inconsequential in a huge, overwhelming world when she shoved you into a tree that you couldn't escape.
You could barely walk because the tree trunk was so small. You had to take tiny steps just to keep balance. Only 10 minutes into the play, Jesse Gibbons, who dressed as a skunk, bumped into you. You fell.
At the age of 7, second grade, you traveled down, 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 and a short, unhappy life flashed before your eyes.
You lay on the floor for the rest of the play because your arms were strapped at your sides. Miss Griswold was whispering frantically from the wings.
Keep going, you little delinquents. There's an audience out there. Don't you dare stop.
No one stopped the play to help you up, and by the second act of this five-act epic called Mother Earth is your patient and you are the nurse, everyone had forgotten that you are inside the papier-mâché tree, and it started sitting on you during their scenes. The papier-mâché buckled over your face, and you were sure your classmates dressed as skunks, chipmunks, and flowers were going to come crashing from your costume and suffocate you. Hour after hour, you could only lay there and stare at your own bark as your classmates recite their horrible lines. Oh, Earth, we love you like crazy. We're sorry we sometimes get sloppy and lazy.
The trees all around like Maple Beach and Ash. You should have to put up with all of our trash.
When the play was finally over and everyone had taken their bows and had exited the stage, you were still left there, a fallen and forgotten tree feebly calling for help. By the time your mother found you, you had given up and gone to sleep. But in that sleep, you had your first nightmare, where Miss Griswold was a giant tree coming at you. The 1,000 play strips hanging from her branches. You couldn't run. You couldn't scream. You couldn't move. That dream came back night after night for weeks and months. Eventually, you had it less and less often. But every time you do, even last week, you wet your bed.
A classic case of post-traumatic stress syndrome. You poor, poor child.
So anytime you hear someone talk about a play, you smell papier-mâché. And you see the inside of the tree, and you hear Miss Griswold's voice saying,
"Needs!
Needs!"
And you walk away
very, very quickly.
Reason number three.
Plays take passion, devotion, and commitment. You can't afford to expend any of those things on a play when Travis Thorburn is alive. Look at him! All passion, all devotion, all commitment must be directed at him and him alone. Listen, Travis Thorburn is your everything. He is your sun and moon. He is your breakfast cereal. He is your waking and your sleeping and your daydreams and your night dreams. He is the table. cool breeze in your face. Every breath you take should be exhaled with a single purpose, to say the name Travis.
Travis! Travis! Travis!
Every thought you form should have but a single intention, to visualize Travis.
I think I see him! He looks like a great silver cloud hanging in the sky, the sun streaming through him.
He looks like an enormous plate of lasagna oozing with cheese.
Like a Greek statue.
Like a Roman Colosseum.
Like tickets to the Super Bowl.
Like Travis Thorburn.
Travis!
Do you know what some people do at the end of a play? They bring flowers to the performers.
Here you go, Sudie. Nice job.
That is a crime, a sin, an act of utter blasphemy, because all of the flowers grown in this world are grown to be strewn at the feet of one person and one person only, Travis Thorburn. With Travis Thorburn alive, do you have time to think about a play, memorize for a play, practice for a play, be in a play?
Heck no!
How can you even consider it? Behold the great Travis. What more can you do than try not to faint when he walks into the room? And if he should ever say to you,
get lost, I'm a girlfriend.
What more can you do than feel your aching heart burst into a billion bloody pieces? What more can you do than just lay down and die?
Reason number four.
Sandwiches. Say, you remember back in 54 when we had that big hailstorm that took
cut roof of the old Gibbeth place?
That wasn't in 54, you ninny. That was in 58. 54 was when we had the ice storm that took down the tree next to the turpentine factory.
Well, all I can tell you is we're going to have nice weather for the next couple of days. My bunions ain't aching, and my scalp ain't itching.
And my arthritis ain't flaring up.
And by consulting with Steps, we're almost past your 10th year of high school.
No classes, guy. Guess I'll go to psych today.
And by consulting all these extra options of the weather, you can see how, you can see the kind of stress weather putting on a play will trigger.
So if you've been planning on getting some vacation time, do it! Wait, this just in. A sudden disturbance in the airflow has caused a massive storm heading away. Wind, snow, sleet, hail, everything. Just sticks in the Colorado in less than 24 hours with massive power outages. Well, in this case, I'd tell you not to panic, but that'd be a lie. See ya.
These numbers can't be right. According to the augmented calculations, the power of the 39 parallel, and if we take this the square root of pi and this numerator subdissects the denominator,
the hard drive and the overdrive will see that.
We're gonna get clobbered.
Oh boy, I'm aching.
Mother McCree, my bunions are about to explode! Feel that vein on my forehead. Feel that pulsing. It hasn't pulled like this since the winter of 02.
Run for your lives, y'all coots! Head to the bingo hall and hide under the table if you know what's good for you.
Mother Nature's theory on the leash.
Getting cloudy? Guess I'll go inside.
Listen to that wind howl.
Look at the size of that hail.
You're never gonna survive this!
Causing a massive power outage.
Who turned out the lights?
Food storages, fear and tremble, panic in the streets, weather-induced pandemonium and...
Cleanup after the biggest storm of the century has barely begun. The governor estimates damages will be measured in the billions of dollars, not to mention the untold lives disrupted. The nagging question is, of course, what caused this massive storm? What disturbance in the air could have started it? We have here an expert in the field, Reed Brown, who recently almost finished her 10th year of high school. Reed, what do you attribute to this disaster?
Somebody put on a play? Reason number 7. Play stick!
Reason number 8. Because you're just too shy. You can barely get 2 words out of your mouth in front of an audience. When you have oral presentations in class, you just take a 0. And if someone tried to force you, you'd start to cry. A play? Oh, no. You're painfully shy. That would kill you. Standing under those bright lights, knowing people are judging you, judging what you're wearing, judging what you're saying, judging the way you're standing, you'd be mortified. I mean, it's a completely unreasonable request. To ask you to be in a play, I mean, they might as well just ask you to stand against a wall so they can assemble a firing squad to have you shot, right? You're shy, remember? Hands freezing, armpits dripping, knees knocking, head pounding shy. Is that a problem? Is it? Just because you're shy, can't you be allowed to stand in a corner and be that way? Or does society absolutely require that no matter how traumatizing it might be, you have to get on some stage and do whatever some script requires? So what if a script says sing the ABCs like you're an opera star? Are you just gonna go ahead and start singing? That's way too much to ask of a shy person. And if the script calls that you grab some strange guy and hold him close as if you could never live without him, and if he commands that you stroke his hair and grab his shirt as if he was your favorite teddy bear, and if it calls that you kiss him passionately.
No. I'm saving myself.
You see? He's too shy for that, and so are you. So no, you can't be in a play. And no, you can't sing opera. And no, you can't grope some guy. And no, you can't get on some stage and possibly make a fool out of yourself in front of an audience. And why? Because you are way too amazingly, incredibly, pitifully shy.
She'll start breaking out into halves. Her legs will swell 5 times the normal size. And she'll start to sneeze uncontrollably. Please excuse her.
Reason number 10. Because you'll be in the play. You'll think you did a good job. You'll go out for pizza with the cast afterwards, and you'll all agree the whole thing was a kick. And then you'll go home and you'll have this conversation with your mother.
Aunt, you're home.
I'm home.
You're later than I thought you'd be.
The pizza took a while.
Mm-hmm. You had pizza?
Yeah.
Did you have pepperoni?
I don't remember.
You did, didn't you?
I told you I don't remember.
You're telling me you don't remember. It means you went ahead and had pepperoni, which always gives you the gas.
Okay, I'll try not to get the gas.
Look, that'll make a difference. Whether you try or not, you'll get it, and you won't be able to help it in your sleep.
Okay, fine, then I'll just close the door.
That'll help. You'll just bottle it up all night, and then when I go to open the door in the morning, I'll be killed.
It's not that bad.
You should not eat pepperoni.
So, how did you like the play?
It was good.
How did I do?
You're fine.
And
what?
Well, you might as well just go ahead and say it.
Say what?
What you didn't like the play or my performance.
I didn't say I didn't like it. I said it was good, and you were fine. What's wrong with being good and fine?
Well, normally, it's good and fine has a but attached to it.
No, it doesn't.
It does so.
The only butt I have is the one I'm sitting on.
Ha ha, very funny, Ma. Now tell me.
I don't have anything to say. It was good. You were good. You were good in the good play.
But?
Why does there have to be a but?
I don't know why there always has to be a but. But every time I do something positive, such as a play, I'll come home, I think I did good. I'll go to sleep, and then you'll come marching in my room like an elephant at 1 a.m. to wake me up pointlessly just to tell me what you didn't like about my performance. Either that, or I'll be walking out the door to go see my friends, and then he'll just lower my mood.
Well, maybe, just maybe, smart Alec, I don't have a butt this time.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
I did good.
You did good.
I was good in the good play.
You were good in the show.
Thank you. Now, I feel good about myself. I'm going to bed.
There was one thing.
I knew it.
I didn't say but.
There was one thing, and but are the same thing.
No, they're not.
It is so.
All right, what do you want from me? Perfection? I'm your mother, a living human being, believe it or not. So if I go to play or some other function, maybe, just maybe, I might have a criticism or two. Is that a crime?
So tired.
You go to bed.
No, tell me now.
No, you're tired.
Allow me to help you, mother.
I liked the play. I liked the play.
I liked your performance.
I liked your performance.
But, now you fill in the blank.
There were a few things, actually.
Oh, goody.
And then you'll be up until 2:30 in the morning listening to your mother take that good feeling you had and twist it like a dirty Kleenex until you'll never want to hear the word play again.
Reason number 11.
Thank you.
you want the peas?
I don't want yucky peas.
They're not yucky, you like peas.
Don't wanna, don't wanna.
You have to eat the peas if you want some dessert.
Don't wanna, I don't want yucky peas. No, no.
Honey, why are you doing this?
You watch your little sister throw up the overheating of the peas and you thought, wow, no reasoning, no logic, just pure reaction.
I hate peas, I hate them, wow.
You think, wow, wouldn't it be nice to go back to that way of thinking? Somebody comes up to you and asks you to do something, and your first thought for no reason at all is no, I don't wanna, and you go with it?
Hey, you should be in the play.
No.
Why not?
Don't wanna.
My plays are good for you, and you used to love being in the plays. And I'll help you grow big and strong.
No, I don't wanna.
Why not?
Because I don't wanna. I don't wanna because I don't wanna.
That's no reason.
Don't wanna, don't wanna, don't wanna!
Guys, Norm is being completely unreasonable. Let's be in a play.
No! No play! Stinky play! Ducky play!
Wasn't that beautiful?
Reason number 13.
Makeup people sometimes try to make you, a guy, wear lipstick and blush. And they don't even have the colors to set off your natural skin tone.
Yeah.
Reason number 14.
Though you cannot prove it, you suspect you are the most important person in the world. Though you do not know why, you suspect that surrounding you are spies and assassins whose only mission in life is to eliminate you. Everywhere you go, you catch glimpses of them scurrying around, watching you, observing you, following you every moment of every day. Though you cannot prove it, you heavily suspect that if you should let your guard down for a second, if this silent but stealthy army of enemy infiltrates should catch you unawares and take you down, consequences will be dire. Not only will your family suffer, but so will your community, your state, your nation. Your elimination will cause a massive domino effect that will lead to the demise of the entire world economy. People will live on the streets and beg for scraps of food. The world over, if you are not completely and utterly careful, though you cannot prove it, you are almost certain. These insidious watchers are just waiting for you to begin a play, holding their wrists, fingers poised on triggers, eyes trained on sights, anticipating that at the climax of the play, when you forget you are the world's most important person, and then, poof, it will be over. The devastation will begin. You are almost certain this will happen if you make the fatal mistake of being a play.
Reason number 15.
Go, go!
I don't have it, she does.
I do not, you said you.
You're insane. Who said I had reason number 15?
Wait, I got it.
Reason number 15!
The play might have a part where you're supposed to hold hands.
No, we already did that one. You can't do repeats.
Oh, we did? That's right, we did, didn't we? Sorry.
This is terrible.
What happened to it?
Well, it has to be around here somewhere. Everyone look for it.
Wait a minute. Why do we have to have 15 reasons? I mean, you already have 14 good ones. Heck, 10 would have done the trick. Or even 2 for that matter. Let's just leave it at that.
We can't just leave it at that. We told them 15. We have to do 15.
Says who? Says your mother.
What'd you say about my mother, you?
All right, back off. There's no need to panic. We just need to come up with another 15th reason. She's right, we promised it, so now we have to deliver. So who saw it last?
Play!
No,
we
can't do that one again either.
It was cheating before, it's worse cheating now.
Whatever.
All right, look, of course we've lost it. What about reason number 15 not to be in a play?
Because...
The piranhas!
What about the piranhas?
They have teeth, lots of them.
And
they're biting little fishies.
And
the piranhas will...
Forget it, I lost it.
All right, keep trying. Reason number 15.
Because of the wonderful things he does. Sorry, I love that movie.
Can we please concentrate?
Because being in a play is ordinary.
That sounds like reason number 15 to me. Go on.
I mean, practically everybody does it at one time or another.
I hear you.
Whether it's kindergarten, second grade, or high school, somebody gets you to try it, right?
That's right.
It happens to us all.
So if everybody's doing it, why should you?
Oh, yeah.
You're an individual.
Now you're cooking.
You're not a sheep for the herding.
That's right.
You make your own choices in the world, don't you?
You better believe it.
So when somebody says, hey, be in this play, you just say no.
No!
That's right. No, no, no. And why? I'll tell you why.
Yes, ma'am.
Because being in a play is ordinary. Story, character, setting, lights, makeup, all that is old.
Old as the hills, baby.
All of us are dead. Deader than my uncle's canary. He died last year. You want new? You want exciting? You try this. You try getting up in front of an audience and telling them, we're not putting on a play. In fact, we're going to spend the next half hour telling you why we're not going to put on a play. And you, my friends, you are just going to have to love it.
So did they?
Did they what?
You know, love it?
I don't know. Should we ask?
No. Let's just bow. If they clapped, we'll figure they loved it.
Wait.
What?
What then?
Well, you know, we leave.
Oh.
What's the matter?
Nothing, I guess. Just thought of a new reason is all.
Too late.
Let him talk.
Well, you'll be in a play and go through all the trouble of memorizing all the lines. And then the play will be over. Then you'll go by the theater room the next day and you'll see on the board another play you want to be in. And then you'll be in that play and then another and another and another. And then eventually you'll be hooked. And that, my friends, is called addiction. And addiction is definitely not good, so don't do it! Well, we were at 14, but then we were at 15, but since Gene added his bit in, now we're at 16.
Well, that's fine to me. Too many and too few, I say.
It's not fine. We told them 15. We have to do 15. Not 14, not 16, 15! 15!
Okay, don't blow a gasket. We'll figure it out. Somehow.
How?
Somehow.
For not being in a play, we've been here for quite a while. Let's think of it.
Then solve the problem. 15. 15. You told them 15. We can't reprint the program. Too expensive.
All right. Jeez.
Wait. The last two reasons, they were only half reasons.
What?
They were half reasons.
How do you figure out that?
Because if they weren't half reasons, then we'd be out here for the next 3 hours trying to figure out how to subtract a reason and or make everybody tear up their programs and handwrite new ones or turn back time. And since you yourself just said you're sick of being out here, I calculate that those were actually half reasons. Got me?
All right, everybody, the last two reasons were only half reasons. Everybody in favor?
Aye!
Opposed?
And since two halves make one whole, ladies and gentlemen, and since we were at 14 reasons before this whole problem arose, and 14 plus 1 does indeed equal 15, you have just witnessed